Hello friends, let's do the poem Elegy Written in a Country Churchyard today. This is a very famous elegy written by the poet Thomas Gray. And the spelling of Gray is G-R-A-Y. Now Thomas Gray is a poet who is often categorized as a transition poet. Now, why is he called a transition poet? Because he belonged to that period of time where the Augustan age or the neoclassical age was coming to an end and the romantic age was going to commence. So he and other poets like Collins, Robert Burns, who were his contemporaries, they blended the characteristic features of both the neoclassical school and the romantic school. That is why they were called the transition poets. Gray was born in 1716 and he died in 1771. He was a scholar, a writer, a teacher, and he was teaching at one of the universities there. But though his poems were popular, he published only 13 of them. He was highly self-critical and he kept feeling that most of his poems, you know, were not worthy enough to be published, and that restricted his repertoire to a great extent. And today we remember him mainly for this one single elegy of his. It is an inevitable part of any great anthology of poems. And this poem, he actually started writing the poem somewhere in 1742, following the death of his very close friend, Richard West. But then it was published only, the completed form came out in the sense he completed the poem in 1750. He was not very keen to publish the poem. But then his friend Horace Walpole forced him to publish it in 1751 because unauthorized versions of the poem were getting ready in many places to come out. So then Walpole told him that he has to get it published if he doesn't want fake imprints to come out. And that is how he published in 1751 this great poem, which has continued to entertain and inspire people all these ages. Now in this poem, it's a pretty long one. It has 33 stanzas. Each stanza has 4 lines and the meter is iambic pentameter. And these 4 line stanzas are also called heroic quatrains. So 33 stanzas in all, that's why I said it's a pretty long poem. And the main theme here is the classical theme of memento mori, means remember that you must die. So death is the predominant theme in this particular poem. It is an elegy, as I mentioned earlier. And it was inspired by the death of his friend Richard West. It does follow the conventions of an elegy, a traditional elegy. But then this elegy is very special because it is not dedicated to any one person. He doesn't mention Richard West anywhere, though it is believed that Richard West's death must have prompted him to write this poem. But nowhere is the name of Richard West mentioned. This poem is dedicated to all the people, the ordinary mortals like you and me, who live a life which has nothing special to be mentioned, who just go through the daily routines and deliberations of life and die and then go to their eternal sleep in some unknown grave. At the time of the composition of this poem, Thomas Gray was said to have lived in the place called Stoke Poges. And in the neighborhood, there was this church called St. Giles Parish Church. And the church in this particular poem is believed to be that church, St. Giles Parish Church at Stoke Poges. Now let me go on to the poem. So the setting is this place. He doesn't mention the place, but then there is this speaker in the poem who is just taking a stroll in the evening. It is very clearly mentioned that the time is evening, late evening. And in the first three stanzas, he describes to us the evening scene in that. And it is again a poem with a pastoral setting, though you don't have any pastoral characters mentioned. It has a pastoral setting because it is set in a rural place, a village. And the first three stanzas paint a beautiful word picture about the evening descending on the earth. So let's take a look at those stanzas. The curfew tolls the knell of parting day. The lowing herd wind slowly over the lea. The ploughman homeward plods his weary way and leaves the world to darkness and to me. Now fades the glimmering landscape on the sight, and all the air a solemn stillness holds, save where the beetle wheels his droning flight, and drowsy tinklings lull the distant folds. Save that from yonder ivy-mantled tower, the moping owl does to the moon complain of such, as wandering near her secret bower, molest her ancient solitary reign. Okay. So stanza 1 begins with the curfew. What is a curfew? It is the church bells ringing, the evening bells. So the curfew denotes the sound of the church bells. So somewhere in a distant place, he can hear the sound of the church bells tolling, and it announces that it is evening. The curfew tolls the knell of parting day. And you can see he gives us a typical picture of a rural setting. What happens there? Now in the evening, what happens? You have the lowing herd wind slowly over the lea. So you have herds of cattle. They are all moving homewards, because the cattle, their routine is set, and every day, even if there is nobody to guide them, you know that in the evening they'll come back home. So the lowing herd, they're making all kind of lowing noises, and they're slowly walking over the lea, the plains, towards their home. The ploughman homeward plods his weary way. So again, you have a farmer, a peasant, a ploughman who had been working hard throughout the day in the fields. Now he is also walking homeward, and here we have a classic example. Now this sentence is cited as an example of a transferred epithet, and a transferred epithet is when one adjective is it is attributed, the quality is attributed to something else. Like for instance, the ploughman homeward plods his weary way. Actually, the adjective weary is attributed, or it actually belongs to ploughman. Who is weary? It is the ploughman who is weary. But where does the poet put the word? He clubs it along with way. So he makes it weary way. So it is a transferred epithet, because the adjective weary does not qualify the noun way, but instead it qualifies the ploughman. So it should have been like this: the weary ploughman homeward plods his way. So here you have a transfer. Something that belongs elsewhere is put in another place. This is called a transferred epithet. When you say, I spent a sleepless night, that again is an example of a transferred epithet, because the night was not sleepless, but I was sleepless. So when I say sleepless night, that becomes a transferred epithet. My sleeplessness is transferred onto the night. So here, the evening, the ploughman is walking home and leaves the world to darkness and to me. So all are going home. So only I am left there, and darkness is descending. Now fades the glimmering landscape on the sight. So he says it's getting darker and darker. You can almost see it, you know, you can visualize it. So as he stands there, or as he's just slowly walking, the light is slowly dimming, fading, and he can hardly see anything. The glimmering landscape slowly fades. And all the air, a solemn stillness holds. You know the time of twilight, how it is. Before full darkness sets in, there is a very solemn feeling around some 6:30 at that time. And then everything is kind of serious and solemn, and there is a kind of silence, save where the beetle wheels is droning flight. So there are very little, very few noises to be heard. One noise that disturbs the solemn stillness is the sound of the beetle. The beetle, you can hear the droning sound of the beetle that is flying. And then you can hear another sound. And what is that? The drowsy tinklings lull the distant folds. So far away in the folds, a fold is a place where the sheep are kind of enclosed. In the open fields, there would be a kind of a wooden boundaries built, and inside you have all the sheep kept. So somewhere in the distant fields, as he's walking, he can hear the tinkling sounds of the bells tied to the necks of these sheep. So he can hear the drowsy tinklings. Why is it drowsy? Because it is distant. He cannot hear it clearly. It is kind of muffled. Save from that yonder ivy mantle tower, the moping owl. Okay. And then he says, I can hear another noise. And what is that noise? It is the moping sound of the moon. And the moon is complaining. And where is the owl sitting? It is somewhere on the ivy mantle tower. There is maybe the church tower. He is standing somewhere close to the church. And there is a tower, and there is a tower which is fully covered with, overgrown with ivy, the plant ivy. That's why he says ivy mantle. Mantle is a kind of a cloak that you wear, and so ivy mantled means a tower that has been completely covered with ivy leaves. And it's somewhere there you have this owl, and the owl is making a very moping and unhappy noise. And the owl is actually complaining to the moon. What is it complaining about? That there is somebody wandering here by my secret bower to molest her ancient solitary reign. So usually in the night, the owl is the ruler or the king of that entire place. Nobody, no human beings are seen walking around. But today, this fellow, that is the poet or the speaker, is wandering here and disturbing me. That is why. So molest here means is kind of disturbing her ancient solitary reign. So she is not used to having people roaming around at this time in that place. She is not happy about it. So she is complaining to the moon. So those three stanzas tell us about the evening, the descending evening. Now he's walking, and he has reached the cemetery, the place where all the graveyard, where the people are buried or the dead are buried. And he comes there. Beneath those rugged elms that yew trees shade, where heaves the turf in many a mouldering heap, each in his narrow cell forever laid, the rude forefathers of the hamlet sleep. So he says, beneath, now he, as I told you, is standing near or standing in the graveyard. He can see some trees there, and the usual trees that you find in an English churchyard, from what we have read in poems and novels. There are some rugged elm trees, big, huge elm trees. Then you have a yew tree. Yew tree again is always a symbol of death and mourning. So something that you always associate with graveyards. So you have a yew tree also, and under the shade of these trees, now it is night time, and so maybe the shade of these trees are falling on the entire the place. And he can see many where heaves the turf in many a mouldering heap. So there you can see some graves. Heaving is when it rises up. So you can see certain mounds wherever a person is buried. You know how a grave would look. You have mud kind of in a heaving kind of a mode. It is there, all kept there. And he can see a heap, a mouldering heap, mouldering maybe because inside you have the remains of a dead person. which is decaying and which has decomposed. So you can see many, many, many such graves. And in each narrow cell, so one grave is one cell, okay? In each narrow cell, there is one dead person who is laid forever in rest. And who are these people? These people are the rude forefathers of the hamlet. Hamlet here, the hamlet actually is a very remote village. It's a very small village, totally kind of rustic, far away from the city. That kind of a place is called a hamlet. So here the people who are buried there in this cemetery are all the rude forefathers. Rude here doesn't mean rude in today's sense. Then you say that somebody is rude, you say that somebody is very arrogant, somebody is kind of cruel. But here rude means the uncouth, the uneducated, okay, rugged. That is what he means by rude here. The rude forefathers of the hamlet sleep. And then he starts talking about these people, the ones who are lying buried under the earth. He says, the breezy call of incense breathing morn, the swallow tittering from the straw-built shed, the cock's shrill clarion or the echoing horn, no more shall rouse them from their lowly bed. He says, all of them are gone to a world far away from here. Nothing can bring them back. And then he tells us about the usual sounds that can be heard in a village. The breezy call of incense breathing morn. So early morning, there is a gentle, cool breeze, the zephyr, okay? So that is one. Then the swallow, the birds, twittering from straw-built sheds. You can hear the twittering sound of the swallow. The cock's sound. You know that the cock usually crows early in the morning. Clarion is a call. So here the shrill clarion refers to the sound of the cock. And then the echoing horn, that is the horn of the hunters. The hunters maybe who have gone for late night hunting and they're coming back. Or they're going off early in the dawn. Usually it is they go at the night and they come back early in the morning. So, or the echoing horn. So these are the usual sounds that you hear in a hamlet like this. And he says, but none of these sounds are going to rouse these people from their lowly bed. Why is it lowly? Because it is there in the ground, in the mud. So no such sound is going to bring them back or awaken them from their eternal sleep. For them, no more the blazing hearth shall burn, or busy housewife ply her evening care. No children run up to lisp their sire's return, or climb his knees the envied kiss to share. What a beautiful picture. A very heartwarming picture he gives us. So these people who are lying dead there are going to miss all the simple pleasures of domestic life. So usually, if when they were alive, what would happen in the evening? You saw in the first stanza, homeward, plodding, tired man. So what would happen when he goes home? So there, his wife would keep a blazing hearth, the fireplace would all be alighted and ready for him, because the wife knows that he is tired after a long day of work. And so a blazing hearth would greet him. And then the housewife, she would be busy with 101 things, but then she would ply her evening care. Ply is to put something on somebody, to kind of overwhelm a person with something. Like when you are a special guest in a relative's house, they ply food on you. When they serve food, they force you, they tell you, eat some more, till you reach satiety. And so here, in the evening, when the husband comes, the wife kind of fusses over him. She brings him tea, she comes and removes his shoes, and she lights the fire for him. She gives him maybe a piece of bread or cake or whatever he wants to eat. So that is what he means by saying busy housewife ply her evening care. And again, and then children would run up to you, and the sire here is a father. So when the father comes back, the children run lisping. Lisping is talking in a very unintelligible kind of way. When little children, you know, like when they cannot really speak very clearly, They come running to their father, calling him all kind of endearing names, and they clamber onto his knees, and he gives them kisses. And maybe usually the youngest one or the one who gets on to him first would get the kiss. That's why envied kiss. Everybody wants to be kissed by the father. And so this is what usually happens if it is a very happy kind of a house. This is what happens in the evening. But unfortunately, these people have been denied of these pleasures. So for them, no more any of these experiences that were mentioned now, none of these would be available to these dead men. Oft did the harvest to the sickle yield, their furrow oft the stubborn glebe had broke. How jocund did they drive their team afield, how bowed the woods beneath their sturdy stroke. Now he talks about how hardworking these people used to be when they were alive. You know, once upon a time, they used to be so hardworking, and they would do their harvest with their sickle. Sickle, you know, is that bent knife with which they would hold the wheat or the corn or whatever, and they would cut it like this. That is the sickle. So they were all expert workmen. So they have so many times they have done harvest with their efficient hands using the sickles, and with their furrows, with their plows, they have broken the stubborn glebe. Glebe is the hardened mud. Maybe after a winter season, they have to break the ground for the next round of crops. So with their strength and using their furrows, they would break the glebe. And how jocund did they drive their team afield. Team here is the team of oxen or horses or whatever they use in the field. How jocund is very jolly. So how happily they are involved in all these duties, day-to-day duties. How bowed the woods beneath their sturdy stroke. And they used to cut down trees for firewood and for other purposes. And big trees used to bow down before their strength. So now that much about these dead people who are lying, they have no comeback to the present world. So they have lost all these pleasures. Now we have reached stanza 8. And here he says, let not ambition mock their useful toil, their homely joys and destiny obscure, nor grandeur hear with a disdainful smile the short and simple annals of the poor. He says, when I talk about these poor people who lived very, very uneventful lives, the rich people, the ambitious people might make fun of them and say that, you know, why are you talking about all these people? So he warns them, don't mock them. Okay, let not ambition here means ambitious people, affluent people, people who are in positions of great power, and he tells them, do not mock their useful toil, because these people, they were toiling throughout their life and their toil was so useful because they fed so many people with their toil. Because farmers, you know, through their hard work, they feed so many mouths. They're not just working for themselves. So let not ambition mock the useful toil, their homely joys. Homely here means ordinary, very simple joys. Destiny obscure. Their obscure destinies means they were not famous. Nobody knew about them, but don't make fun of them. Now grandeur here with a disdainful smile, the short and simple annals of the world. Grandeur again, the people belonging to maybe aristocratic families, or as I said earlier, the rich and the noble families. So you might listen to all this with a disdainful smile. So he says, don't do that. When I talk about the short and simple annals, annals here is when I talk about their lives, the historical records about are generally called annals. So here, when I say the simple stories of the poor, do not have a disdainful smile on your face. The boast of heraldry, the pomp of power, and all that beauty, all that wealth ever gave, awaits alike the inevitable hour. The paths of glory lead but to the grave. A very famous line. So he says, he warns them, you remember he already told them, don't make fun of these ordinary people, and he gives them the reason why. He says, the boast of heraldry is you know, a sign of being an aristocrat, the noble family. They have all this ornamented kind of shields and decorations which declare that the family is great, and they have all the show, the boastful what ornamentations to show their greatness, and the pomp of power and the beauty. Some people might be so proud that they're very beautiful, and some others might be proud of their wealth. But all these people, everything that you got from your beauty and your wealth and from your power and your heraldry, everything awaits alike the inevitable hour. And what is this inevitable hour he's talking about? Undoubtedly, it is death. So he says, beware. Death comes to all, not just to these poor people, but even to you, the high and mighty. Definitely, you too will one day face death. And that is why he says, the paths of glory lead but to the grave. So even when you are glorious, when you are famous, when you are powerful, you might start believing that you can escape from death too. But my dear friend, that's not true. So even the paths of glory will ultimately lead to the grave. Now, that's why I mentioned right in the beginning that one predominant theme of this poem is memento mori, or remember that you must die. Okay, and then he says, nor you, ye proud, impute to these the fault, if memory over their tomb no trophies raise, where through the long-drawn ale and fretted vault, the pealing anthem swells the note of praise. So nor you, so he once again, he continues that because he was one person who mingled with the elite class. Maybe he knew how these people considered the poor people, the kind of arrogance they had, the kind of despise they showed towards the people who lived in villages. That is why he's telling them, nor you proud, those among you who are proud, impute to these the fault, if memory over their tomb. So don't blame these people for not having great tombs or great trophies. Usually when rich people die, you have very elaborate and ornamented graves built with tombstones and carvings and statues and all that. He says, don't blame them if they don't have such tombs over their graves, where through the long drawn aisle, the fretted world. What is an aisle, by the way? An aisle is a path between when you have in the church, for instance, or in your classroom, when you have benches on both sides and you have a path in between, that is called an aisle. Okay, and the S is silent there. And when you travel in a plane and when you book tickets, you would be asked whether you want an aisle seat or a window seat. So an aisle seat would be the seat close to this passage in between. Okay. And even in a bus, you have an aisle, where through the long drawn aisle and fretted vault. A fretted vault is a vault. What is a vault, by the way? It is a kind of a huge tomb. A tomb, T-O-M-B. And fretted is something that is decorated with intricate designs, maybe marble with carvings and all that. That is fretted. So, where through the long drawn aisle and fretted wall, the pealing anthem swells the note of praise. So don't blame them if they don't have big vaults and big tombstones where you can hear, and again in very famous churches maybe, where you can hear the pealing anthem. When a great person, famous person dies, the church bells are toll for him. So again, those of you who are pride, don't blame these people for not having all these extravagances. Then he asks the very relevant question, can storied urn or animated bust back to its mansion call the fleeting breath? Can honor's voice provoke the silent dust, or flattery soothe the dull cold ear of death? So he asks the question, can a storied urn, you know, it's It's a kind of a, maybe a marble container, a big one, in which the ashes or the bones of the dead are stored. Storied urn, because these people, they used to keep store there, especially the rich and the affluent people, they used to have storied, means one, an urn which was beautifully carved with all kind of stories. Now you have the poem, The Grecian Urn by John Keats, where he sees one such urn and writes a poem about it. So storied urn. Or animated bust. Now, what is a bust, by the way? A bust is a statue of a person from here onwards, your chest onwards to your head. Okay, that is a bust. And so he's animated bust. That is a very lively looking bust. So if you keep your statue there, a bust there, or if you store a person's remains in a very ornamental and decorated urn, will it bring back the dead? That is the question he asks. Whether a person is buried in just plainly in the earth, like these villages, or even if whether they are put into a decorated vault or a storied urn, it's all the same. Just because they are put in an urn, or just because they are put in a fretted vault, will they be brought back to life? No, they won't. Can honor's voice provoke the silent dust? So honor, just because you are an honorable person, will your the silent dust again, is it symbolizes death, or the ashes or the remains of the body, will it bring it back? Will it bring a person back from death? Or flattery soothe? So when death comes, can you just flatter death and send him back? You can't do that. Once death arrives, you have no option but to go along with him. Now, stanza 12. Perhaps in this neglected spot is laid some heart once pregnant with celestial fire, hands that the rod of empire might have swayed, or waked to ecstasy the living lyre. So from here on, already he has told us, don't make fun of these people. And now he says, what do we know? Maybe these people who are lying dead in this unknown churchyard, if they had a different fate, if they had been born maybe in a city, if they had been born in palaces, they would have turned out to become famous people. Who knows? Okay, so from here onwards, for some 4 to 5 stanzas, he tells us about these people and the opportunities that were denied to them by their fate. Perhaps in this neglected spot is laid some heart once pregnant with celestial fire, hands that the rod of empire might have swayed, or waked to ecstasy the living lyre. So then we can never say, maybe there must be in this neglected spot, they must be lying buried, a man whose heart was pregnant with celestial fire, means a man with immense capacity, celestial fire, divine fire. He could have become maybe a great poet, he could have become a great orator, a great religious or a spiritual leader, or there might be somebody whose hands had the capacity to rule nations, hands that the rod of the empire might have swayed, who could have become great administrators, soldiers, and they could have controlled or held nations to their sway. Or they could also have been people who could wake to ecstasy the living lyre. Lyre is a musical instrument. So maybe there is a musician lying here, dead, unknown. There would have been people with immense capacity to compose music, to sing well. Who knows? So how can you make fun of them? But knowledge to their eyes, her ample page, rich with the spoils of time. So what happened? What was that knowledge? Chose not to reveal herself to them. Her ample page means her. These people were denied education. So they never ever got a chance to acquire knowledge. Ample page, rich with the spoils of time, here means knowledge of so much of experience, so much of information. This knowledge was denied to them, or this book of knowledge was never presented before those people. So they lived and died without an education, and so they could not bring their talent to fruition. Is it their fault? No, it is not. But knowledge to their eyes, a ample page, rich with the spoils of time. Spoils of time, I guess, experiences gathered over the years. None of that was revealed, unrolled, revealed to these people. And chill penury is poverty. So though some of them must have had great aspirations, noble rage, great aspirations to do mighty things, because of their poverty, they would not have been given a chance to do that. Maybe somebody wanted to learn, but then his parents couldn't afford to send him to a school. Maybe there were no schools at all in that village. They had to go somewhere else. Maybe they didn't even know about all this. So penury, poverty must have repressed their noble rage, froze the genial current of the soul. Genial, again, they must have had genial is friendly, joyous. So they might have had this a musician within them. They might have been a writer. They might have been a sculptor. Who knows? But this penury froze all their talents, and they remained, and they lived and died as unknown people. And then this again is a very famous stanza. Full many a gem of purest ray serene, the dark unfathomed caves of ocean bear. Full many a flower is born to blush unseen and waste its sweetness on the desert air. So he says that in the caves of the ocean, somewhere under, deep down beneath the oceans, in some unfathomed caves, unknown, undiscovered caves under the ocean, there might be some gems or maybe pearls lying there, purest, most precious. But who knows that they are there? It might be lying there. Same way, there might be many flowers that bloom in the desert. But then, since a desert is not visited often by people, there might be so many flowers that bloom and go unnoticed because there is nobody to see them. So here, you can see here the comparison is to these people. Just like precious gems or pearls that lie in the ocean bed undiscovered, just like the beautiful flowers that bloom and wither away unnoticed in the desert, same way these people too, among these people too, they might have been really gifted people, but nobody discovered them, and so they lived a quiet life and passed away. Some village Hampton that with dauntless breast the little tyrant of his fields withstood, some mute inglorious Milton here may rest, some Cromwell guiltless of his country's blood. So Hampden is again a great orator and a political leader, and then you have Milton, the great poet, the greatest of poets we can say, Cromwell, the Puritan leader. So he says there might have been people who had the potential to become like these people. Somebody like Hampden, who had a dauntless breast, means a very brave heart, and the little tyrant of his fields withstood, some mute inglorious Milton. So there must have been a Milton. This Hampden must have fought against the tyrant of his fields. So he must have indulged in local fights. His master or his feudal lord might have been a tyrant. And this fellow, this Hampden, because he had the warrior inside him, he might have rebelled against his little tyrant, because that was the most he could do. And then there must have been somebody who had the capacities of Milton, but unfortunately he had to remain mute and inglorious because he did not get a chance to kind of to hone his poetic skills. There must have been a Cromwell who could have become a great leader, but then he didn't get a chance. Some Cromwell guiltless of his country's blood. So then he says that Cromwell was guilty of his country's blood, because Cromwell, he was one of the leaders who rose against Charles I, and which led to the execution or the beheading of Charles I. That is why Cromwell, the real Cromwell, was guilty of his country's blood, because he was a reason for the death of his king. But here in this village, among these dead people, there might have been a Cromwell who was guiltless of his country's blood. The applause of listening senates to command, the threats of pain and ruin to despise, to scatter plenty over smiling land and read the history in a nation's eyes, their lot forbade. So these things which are mentioned here in this stanza, these things were not permitted to these people. That is what is the first one. If these persons were given an option or they were given a chance, they would have become great orators, great leaders, and listening senates would have applauded when they spoke, would have cheered them, great war heroes. And they might have had, the great soldiers among them might have had chances to despise threats of pain and ruin. That is, they would have taken part in battles, they would have been wounded, they would have had threats on their life, but they would despise all that, because brave men don't bother about such things. To scatter plenty over a smiling land. So if you are a king, you have the power to make your people happy by scattering plenty over them, by giving them a good administration, by making life comfortable for them. So a king could spread happiness and prosperity on his smiling land and read their history in a nation's eye. So these great heroes, when they look at their people in front of them, they can see their history written there, because they know that they will be remembered forever as great heroes. But all that was forbidden to these people. Here again, you have an example of an enjambment, where the last line of the stanza doesn't put an end to the idea, but it is carried on to the next line. This is an enjambment. So, and read their history in a nation's eyes, their lot forbade, nor circumscribed alone their growing virtues, but their crimes confined. So he says, just like the virtues of these great men, famous men, were denied to these people, in the same way, even their crimes were denied. Because these people lived in this hamlet, denied of all the opportunities that the others enjoyed, it is true that they forfeited the chance for many good fortunes. At the same time, we should also remain that because they were here, they were exempted from doing many evil things too. They escaped from doing many evil things. That is why, nor circumscribed alone their growing virtues, but their crimes confined. Forbade to wade through slaughter through to a throne, and shut the gates of mercy on mankind. Again, enjambment, going on to the next stanza. The struggling pangs of conscious truth to hide, to quench the blushes of ingenuous shame, or heap the shrine of luxury and pride with incense kindled at the muse's flame. So he says that these people, because they lived in these villages, they did not have to indulge in many things that the others did. They did not have to wade through slaughter. That is, oftentimes to become a king, you had to kill people. We have read in history how some people had to kill their own, they had to kill their father. Some others had to kill their own brothers to become the king. So that is what he means by wade through slaughter. So there is a sea of blood, and they had to wade through that to reach the throne. These people were spared of that trouble. Sometimes people had to, these great heroes, they had to behave mercilessly. Maybe when they were dealing with their enemies, they had to kill people, they had to punish people, they had to torture people, they had to burn villages, they had to molest women. None of these crimes these people had to do. The struggling pangs of conscious truth to hide. Sometimes they had to be crafty, they had to lie, tell lies, they had to be dishonest in order to keep their power. That happens, you know, when you have to sustain your power, you have to entertain other people, you have to support some of their we know all these ministers, some ministers in our country too, who support all these mafia people and all the terrorists. And why do they do that? Did they know it's not right? But then they have to at any cost hold on to their power. So they might have to do or support or help these shady kind of people. So here, these people of the village did not have to indulge in any of these bad things. So they did not have to go through the struggling pangs of conscious truth to hide. And sometimes they had to go through very shameful experiences. They would have to suffer insults in order to, you know, you sometimes have to listen, you have to stand and face the insult which the higher people heap on you. But then you cannot say anything in return because you are afraid you will lose your position. So they have to quench the blushes. Quench is to suppress the blushes. Blush is when your face becomes red when somebody insults you. So they had to suffer all that. Or heap the shrine of luxury and pride with incense kindled at the muse's flame. Sometimes poets had to write poems to please the rich people. I think that's what he means by saying heap the shrine of luxury and pride with incense kindled at the muse's flame. So he is kind of talking against or berating the poets who write for money, who write poems glorifying the kings and aristocrats just to be in favor. So sometimes, you know, artists are forced to do that. You have to paint a picture or you have to write a poem according to the instructions of the rich man, because otherwise he'll be angry and he will not be your patron anymore. So none of these humiliations these people had to suffer. It is true that they did not enjoy the privileges of the rich and the powerful. Same way, they did not have to undergo the kind of sufferings that the rich and the powerful undergo. Far from the madding crowd's ignoble strife, their sober wishes never learned to stray. Along the cool sequestered vale of life, they kept the noiseless tenor of the way. So these people lived a very calm and serene life, far from the madding crowd. So you must have heard this name. It's a name of a very famous novel by Thomas Hardy, Far from the Madding Crowd. There too you have the life of a village and the life in the village portrayed. So here these people, so it is from this poem that Thomas Hardy took those words, took the title of his novel. Far from the madding crowd. So where do we have this madding crowd? We have the madding crowd in the cities, in these centers of power and among the rich people, because there is a lot of hustle and bustle to hold on to what you have, to conquer others. So in the village there is nothing. Life goes on at such an easy and a calm pace. Far from the madding crowd's ignoble strife. Ignoble because often these noble people have to do ignoble things in order to maintain their status and their levels of comfort. These people don't have to bother about any such things. Far from the madding crowd's noble strife, their sober wishes never learned to stray. They never had any lofty ambitions. That is why sober wishes. Their ambitions and their aims of life never went far away from their village. Everything that they wanted, they managed to satisfy within their limited circle. Along the cool, sequestered here, sheltered, calm, protected. Along the cool, sequestered vale of life, they kept the noiseless tenor of their way. So they maintained a very smooth and a very uneventful, at the same time, a happy tone of life, noiseless tenor. They had no complaints. They were happy with what they had. They were content. So they lived a peaceful and a happy life, though it did not have any of the glitter and the glamour of the people of the cities. They were happy in their own way. So we have completed stanza 18. Now the rest of the poem I will continue with in the next video.